And I'll give the floor now to the PR of Sri Lanka. Mohan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We thank the Permanent Mission of Mexico for organizing this timely event to look at the issues of upholding collective security under the United Nations Charter and the issue of the use of force in international law, non-state actors, and self-defense. When the founders of the UN pledged to save succeeding generations, Mr. Chairman, from the scourge of war, emerging from the ravages of two world wars and a historical past where differences between states were often settled by war, the Charter is notable for expressly prohibiting the use of war as an instrument of state policy and affirmed the selective applicability of those principles, affirmed the primacy of prevention and peaceful settlement of disputes. Now, the universal and non-selective applicability of those principles are clearly evident in Article 2 of our Charter. Now, this principle has been given much importance that it has found a place across the road from the United Nations, as such importance has found a place, as I said, across the road from the United Nations, where a monument stands with an inscription from Isaiah, which says, "They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears to pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." Now, one would wonder if this was only meant to be a nice phrase or what we really wish to live by those pledges, as the world appears to be in a state of absolute chaos. Now, an ongoing example of this wisdom of Isaiah, perhaps in current times, is the need for the dismantling of nuclear weapons and the use of their components as fuel in civilian electric power stations, the megaton to megawatts program. The nuclear fission development used in World War II has now been used to generate electricity and radiopharmaceutical production. Now, what kind of force, I ask, then is within the concept of the jus ad bellum? This argument appears to be that there exists a gravity threshold below of which the prohibition of the use of force is inapplicable. Put differently, the prohibition of the use of force covers all physical force which surpasses the minimum threshold levels of intensity. In other words, a small incident to be brought under control must be responded to with correspondingly small measures. An example would be the neutralization of a single individual with force that is not commensurate with that particular act of neutralization, or the example of the abduction of persons forcibly, or perhaps the interception of a small vessel at sea by a warship. Now, there are numerous acts that can be classified as encounters between military units. It would therefore appear that to exclude small-scale or targeted acts from the ambit of Article 2.4 is a moot point, as it appears to be inconsistent with customary practice and cannot be recommended as a matter of policy. It is clear that Article 2.4 enjoins all members from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state or in any manner inconsistent with the purposes of the United Nations. So in the emerging multipolar world, what we are experiencing, Mr. Chairman, is that it is necessary to re-examine the inadmissibility of the use of force outside the Charter provisions and without proper authorization by the Security Council. There is also a need to ensure that where there are cases of the use of force authorized, it should be employed responsibly with action that should be judicious, proportionate, and strictly limited to the objectives of the mandate and in line with the international humanitarian law in view of the emerging threats to international peace and security. There are two generally accepted exceptions to the prohibition of the use of force under international law, as we all know. The use of force authorized by the Council, where there exists a threat to the peace, breach of peace, or an act of aggression, and the inherent right to self-defense of sovereign states under Article 51 and customary international law. However, we remain concerned about the increasing number of instances where the use of force has been applied unilaterally, invoking a right of self-defense pursuant to Article 51 of the Charter against non-state actors in other territories. these exceptional cases should not be considered as a new norm or evidence of state practice. It must be highlighted that the Charter includes sufficient provisions regarding the use of force that should be done strictly in conformity with the relevant Charter provisions. The use of force in self-defense against terrorist groups is one of the most controversial issues in the field of the jus contra bellum today. It may be noted that in several instances, the application of Article 51 has been limited, and that the ICJ has also pronounced upon this recently and has said that it is restrictive and should not be rewritten or reinterpreted. There has been an increase in Article 51 cases being invoked against non-state actors. It may, however, be noted that Article 51, as well as the ICJ advisory opinion on the legal consequences of the construction of the separation wall, made it clear that attacks on non-state actors that gives the right of self-defense must come from states and not from state actors. So finally, the peaceful settlement of disputes and the prevention of conflicts must remain key aspects in the work of the UN to strengthen regional and international peace and security. The United Nations may further promote and assist states in utilizing applicable means specified in Article 33 of the Charter for the settlement of disputes. The outer parameters of the notion of self-defense has been increasingly pushed as to what constitutes an armed attack and by whom and what is meant by imminence, necessity, or proportionality. It would therefore appear that the breadth of the right of self-defense remains rather unsettled and presently driven by political or legal considerations. Some parties want a rather elastic interpretation, while others make out a case for the liberalization of the use of force. Now, the argument may well culminate in the right of self-defense being interpreted to strengthen the prohibition of war and enhance human security. It seems to be suggested that it is better to interpret the state as a collectivity of individual human beings, and upon this hypothesis, an armed attack to be reconceptualized as a serious violation of human rights. It is not difficult to therefore appreciate that the response to such an attack then raises similar questions as in the case of humanitarian intervention. It has been a moot point amongst academia that there is a desirability of a draft declaratory resolution on self-defense in the light of the uncertainties surrounding the scope of self-defense. One such attempt was the principles governing self-defense against non-state actors, which is known as the Bethlehem Principle, which recognizes the need to bridge the gap between academic discourse and the operational needs of state, and to bring some clarity and precision to when state actors may use force in the territory of another state against armed attacks by non-state actors. To conclude, it is observed that the very concept of the right of self-defense has been called into question in the context of a blurring of the differences, as one academic puts it, between what is external and what is internal, together with the growing consciousness of belonging to one human family. Human security, Mr. Chairman, is about the security of individuals, in protecting individuals. Therefore, the lives of other individuals also must be taken into consideration. The use of force, therefore, must be sustainably managed. It is therefore a critical question for us to consider, or worthy of consideration by this assembly, as to whether there can be a difference between a war approach and a human rights approach. Thank you.
Thank you.